Coming up, we launch a new art series, First Fridays on Focus. Reporter Brittany Garzillo turns up the heat in the Banana Factory's hot glass studio. Then I introduce you to a different type of glass artist. This painter turns trashed windows into whimsical works of art that you can see in one of Bethlehem's newest art galleries. These stories, plus we explore the healing powers of art therapy and provide a preview of the shows coming to a stage near you. Get ready to explore the arts on Focus.
Focus showcases the people, places, and issues that matter to you.
Everybody has a story.
These are the stories that uplift and inspire right here in your neighborhood.
Focus on what matters. You never know what you're going to see when you tune into Focus.
Support for Focus is provided by
Thank you for joining us. I'm Laura McHugh. In this episode, we begin a new series. We'll devote the first week of each month to the local art scene. In fact, we've brought a piece of that art scene into our studio with hand-blown glass made at the Banana Factory in South Bethlehem. That's where we start the show with Focus reporter Brittany Garzillo.
Thank you, Laura. From vases and bowls to decorative pumpkins, these artists handcraft molten glass into one-of-a-kind works of art right before your eyes. The artists you're about to meet make glass blowing look easy, but as I quickly learned, it's both difficult and rewarding.
Talent, teamwork, 2,000 degree heat. The glass blowing artists at the Banana Factory in South Bethlehem turn up the heat on traditional art as they mold molten glass into masterpieces.
To me, it's an art that's almost like a sport. So the molten glass is actually located inside the crucible.
Artist and glass studio manager Dennis Gardner retrieves what he calls a gather of glass from the 2100 degree furnace and quickly cools down the metal rod before shaping his next piece. Dennis says glass blowing requires both artistic ability and an ounce of athleticism.
But not only is it hot and physically demanding, it's a lot of time on your feet all day, a lot of movement, moving around. So it's kind of like you're active, you're exercising the whole time.
John Choi, artist and creative director of the glass studio, uses tools to effortlessly etch each detail, a skill he's perfected for the past 20 years.
You and the fire and your skill and natural ability and your glass knowledge from your teachers, that's all you have.
Together, both John and Dennis have handcrafted thousands of pieces, from functional bowls and flower sculptures to a 40-foot tall glass sculpture located in Arts Quest.
Transforming molten liquid into a tangible object, to me that's really powerful and very exciting.
According to John and Dennis, the art of glass blowing dates back more than 2,000 years. John demonstrates how glass blowing got its name as he blows into the hollow rod, creating a bubble in the glass. With every turn, the bubble grows bigger and bigger and bigger.
Practice getting the glass out, shaping or blowing or certain tooling. We practice those little steps for years. And believe it or not, some of those moves might take you your lifetime.
Both Dennis and John share their expertise with other aspiring artists in classes offered through the Banana Factory. Some students continue with glass as studio volunteers.
The glass is your teacher. So you need to watch how it's moving in order to take the next step and make what you want to.
Everybody does the same thing differently. So it's up to you to find your way. So that's the beauty of it, because there's no right and there's no wrong. It's what you want to make of it.
According to Arts Quest, the glass studio opened in 2006 and is the only hot glass studio in the Lehigh Valley.
The learning curve is rather steep. And when you see somebody who's blowing glass and they know what they're doing, it looks very easy. So many students come in and they see you make something and they're like, oh, that looks pretty easy. I think I can try it. And just pulling the glass out of the furnace is challenging if you've never done it before.
Up for the challenge, I accepted John's offer to try it myself.
Want to do a pumpkin?
Right, here's one of my favorite tools. We call this the bonker stick.
The bonker
yep,
stick?
Yep, so you want to grab that? Excellent. Now in just 1 second, I want you to tap this part of the stick away from us, okay? Doesn't need to be a home run. We just need a base hit right here, okay? And make sure you hit it away from us, okay? Go for it. Perfect, very nice.
And one of the things about glass blowing is you want to make something that's nice in a team of people. It's very challenging to do by yourself.
And now we're going to put this stem right on top here. Just make sure it contacts all around the piece. And now this glass is nice and hot and molten. So this glass is about 2,000 degrees that we're making the stem out of, and your pumpkin is still very hot, still probably 1,000 degrees, but it's stable. And then the last thing we're gonna do is we're gonna wrap this around our wooden jig here, and then we're gonna put it on your pumpkin.
If the glass were to stay out and cool in the air, it would crack and break. That's why once a piece is completed, it's put in an annealing oven.
A few days later, my glass pumpkin is ready for display.
You can learn from me, but you're not going to blow glass exactly like I do. So you really have to develop your own relationship with the glass, and I think that's a really unique thing with the material.
It's like so much fun. It's like figuring out the puzzle that's been around 2,000 years, and that really excites me.
Whether you're a seasoned pro or just starting out, both Dennis and John agree that glass blowing can ignite the artist in all of us. For Focus, I'm Brittany Garzillo reporting.
Thanks, Brittany. You can learn more about these classes and the artists who teach them at bananafactory.org. In our next story, we meet a different type of glass artist. In warm weather, you'll find him driving through Bucks County, scouring the roadside for his next canvas. Or you can visit him on Main Street in Bethlehem, where he just opened a unique new gallery. In his Bethlehem studio, Ward Van Helt sets down his brush and takes a moment to assess his latest painting.
Right now, I can see that the lips need some work.
So he flips the painting around and gets to work.
I'm working not only in mirror image, but in reverse order.
Ward works on a surface both fragile and unforgiving.
If you make a mistake, there's no going back.
A canvas made of clear glass.
You're looking at the unpainted surface, and the paint is applied to the other side.
This difficult yet unique technique turns painting into a puzzle.
The whole process is reversed. The details are put on before the background,
making each painting look as if it's lit from within.
I love the nature of the glass. I love the luminosity. There's no other support medium combination, I believe, that has that same sort of luminous effect when it's finished.
A painting often takes 4 to 6 months to complete.
Because each layer needs to dry.
And when they're done, Ward displays and sells his finished works and hundreds of others at Bethlehem House Contemporary Art Gallery.
Currently we have 8 artists and 2 furniture makers. We have 6 painters and 2 sculptors, all of whom are local.
Located on Main Street in Bethlehem, Ward opened the gallery in July and designed it not as a white-walled, stark space, but to look as if it's actually someone's home.
It really allows the viewer to not only look at the space and the art in a different way, it gives them ideas in which that they can incorporate these things within their own home.
Visitors walk through wooden double doors into a lobby with vaulted ceilings and an enormous archway.
It is quite impressive. Every single person that has come in here, they typically use the word wow.
The lobby leads to an open concept living area, separated for now by a large rectangular sculpture suspended from the ceiling as a room divider. 4 additional rooms house a bedroom, dining room, den, and music room. Throughout the space, each piece is individually lit with theatrical lighting.
This is still the first exhibit that we have. Every 3 months, the entire space will change. So the art will change, the furniture, and the rooms will change as well.
What won't change, at least anytime soon, the commitment to local artists.
It's a community that is full of great art, great artists, a great art scene that's supported by all of the cities, Bethlehem, Allentown, and Easton, all put a great deal of attention into their art community.
Even Ward's own artwork comes from his environment. He salvages the windows, often right from the side of the road. And though Ward usually leaves the frames as he finds them, the view through the glass never looks the same again. Moving from the studio to the stage, premiering this month at Bucks County Playhouse, a new play called the WTYT 960 Billboard Sitters. Filmmaker Zeke Zelker wrote and directs this interactive play, and he joins me now. Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
It's called an interactive immersive play. What does that mean?
Sure. So it is a play that is scripted. But what makes it interactive is that we developed a mobile app that the audience can interact with the characters via social media, primarily Twitter. And so when people go to the theater, they can download the app in the Apple Store and also in Google Play, and they can literally engage the show. And now why it's immersive is a matter of the audience can actually change the storyline a touch based on what's trending on social media. The other side of it too is we also have DJs that interact with the audience and make it a real immersive, very fun experience. I equate a lot with jazz music where you can, every show is going to be a bit different.
What's the play about?
Sure, it's about a radio station, WTYT 960, that hosts a billboard city contest where four people live in a billboard till one survives to win a mobile home and $960,000. The play is actually the first 960 hours, which equates to the first 40 days of the contest. It is a comedy. There's obviously dramatic elements to it as well. And it's loosely based on a billboard city contest that I remember from my childhood back in 81. And it stayed with me all the way up until my adult years. And it's not about that at all. It's just basically inspired by that original contest.
And so the show is set on basically one set, the entire show. And it's really interesting to see the way you're able to change it. What challenges did that present and how did you address them?
Oh, sure. So literally the set is a catwalk in front of a billboard. So the actors never leave the stage. And so you actually have to readjust things to the point of so the actors are doing, you know, changing intents for costuming and everything else. So it takes a lot of pre-planning and, you know, so that everything is on stage prior to even the show going up. The other interesting thing too that we're doing is we have various sponsors of the play, and then we're able to integrate brand sponsorship into the play itself with the billboard backdrop and so forth.
And so you're encouraging the audience. Normally we say, please put your phones away when you come into the to the theater, and you're encouraging them to get their phones out.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Because it's just how times have changed. It's a matter of, we're trying to bring a new crowd into theater. And by doing that, I feel like we have to hedge a bit younger. And how do you get younger people into theaters is to basically make it more interactive and make part of the entertainment piece a part of their normal lives. And so we really encourage it. We watch things that are trending. We have an entire team of people behind stage that really make everything work. And it's very engaging and fun and interactive. And it's a matter of people becoming a part of something. And really the word of mouth on it is spreading, thank God. And it's gonna be a lot of fun, it really is.
You said there's two large screens, so the Twitter feed is actually represented on stage, but how else does that audience interaction get involved?
Sure, so what it is the characters start the conversation, and there is a storyline that actually goes along with the social media as well. So the audience interacts with the characters. Their tweets will actually be seen up on the screen, and there's also other social media components that are also integrated within the story as well, like through Instagram, through Facebook, and so forth, a lot with images and things. When we first tried this, I should say, at State Theater, it was unbelievable how well it went, and that's actually what enabled us to get to Bucks County. Because quite honestly, like, I'm in a new stage of entertainment where we're creating across multiple platforms, and we have to do with a lot of R&D, meaning research and development. And when you talk about R&D for a creative or an entertainment property, people kind of look at you like, what do you mean? Because quite honestly, we don't know if it's going to work. And thankfully it did. And so now, you know, we're able to take that original concept, perfect it, and now we're bringing it to Bucks County. And Bucks County has an amazing history. You know, started the careers of Robert Redford and Grace Kelly, and it's very humbling to actually be on that stage.
I understand there's plans for a feature film in place?
Yes, absolutely, yes. So this is all part of a multimedia experience where there's the play, there's a web series, which is very similar to the play, but it's complementary, and then there's a movie. We did shoot part of the movie already. We're shooting some of the backstory. And the movie is more so geared towards about what the radio station goes through, where the play and web series is about these four people surviving on a billboard and the craziness that ensues.
How can people find out when they can see it and how?
Sure, absolutely. So if people are interested in the overall project, they can go to billboardmovie.com. Or if they want tickets to see the play next week, it's actually at bcptheater.org is the name of the Bucks County Playhouse's website.
Great. Zeke, thank you so much for sharing this information, and we look forward to following this project.
Thank you. I really appreciate the time.
We'll continue our preview of the local stage scene in just a moment, but first, they say a picture's worth a thousand words. In art therapy, a picture often expresses feelings words can't describe. Focus reporter Grover Silcox spoke with a board-certified art therapist to learn more about how it works. Grover?
Laura, I learned you don't have to be an artist to take art therapy. The art therapist guides you through the imagery which only you can create. It's often a journey, like in traditional psychotherapy, which leads to a sense of well-being and often resolution of behavioral and emotional health issues. For some, art therapy simply restores a sense of well-being. For others, it offers a creative way to manage difficult emotions and behavioral health issues.
There's two ways of looking at art therapy. There is art as therapy and art therapy through art.
On this day, Marie Morrow, a board-certified art therapist and counselor, invites her son Luke and two friends, Amy and Natalie, to demonstrate how she helps clients through art.
And we use art to kind of look inside of ourselves and see what's going on.
Marie's friend Amy, a full-time mom, creates a mandala, or circle, to express the angst she feels as her five kids, each represented by a different colored chalk, leave the nest.
A circle is a very centering shape. It's a very comprehensive shape. It sets a clear boundary. It holds us. You have your mandala of yourself with four of your children leaving, and they've been a really big part of you for many, many, many years.
Yeah, I mean, that's my life. They are my life.
Amy puts her emotions deep into the paper.
I just put it down in feelings of just stretching, like stretching out, like they're leaving, stretching out.
And when we put it in the paper format, like when we put it out on the paper or when we use our hands and build something, things come out that we normally wouldn't be able to verbalize, and we often gain insight.
And insight often leads to solving or at least managing difficult issues.
Well, they're going to go out, and then they're going to have children. And then
they can all come back.
Yeah, it's going to just keep growing.
So my circle will be getting fuller, more colors.
In another room, 15-year-old Luke molds a monster out of clay, a monster, he says, that represents the stress he sometimes feels about school.
Is there truly a physical monster that flies over you? Right. Okay. So the monster is part of your imagination? The feelings are real. But when we know that the monster is not real, it takes away power. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Marie points out that not all monsters are alike.
My clients, they'll create monsters, and sometimes their monsters are scary, and sometimes their monsters are protective. You know, and we talk about that, and how do they protect them, and how do we, if they are a protective monster, how do we hold them close to us?
Marie's third volunteer, Natalie, a high school senior, uses markers to navigate her way through the stress of choosing a college.
I'll have her do a roadmap where she's looking at where she is now, and then where she plans to be in the future. What are the supports that she can put in place to reach her goal?
Natalie draws 12 lines representing 12 colleges that she's considering.
So you have so many, like so much stuff swirling around in there, mm-hmm. and then you have all this anxiety. And so there's so many options. I mean, your future is really very open right now.
Yeah.
I think this is where we would kind of take a step back from the art and kind of figure out the pros and cons of each.
I personally have never done art therapy before, and it helped me let go of some of my anxiety.
One of Marie's clients is quadriplegic and paints for the mental and physical stimulation.
I put paint on his hands, and I massaged it into his hands, and we put it handprints on paper. And for the first time in a decade, he was able to open his hands. It was amazing.
Marie combines art and cognitive behavioral therapy to help clients with everything from anxiety and stress to depression and mood disorders, self-esteem, and other behavioral health issues.
I want to make the bridge secure, so I put the struts in there.
Okay.
She even takes time to help this reporter de-stress with a little artwork of his own.
So I'm kind of thinking about where I've been,
okay.
And I'm kind of thinking about where I'm going.
Okay.
And really, I kind of think that is where I'm at.
Absolutely.
That's where I'm at in life.
Absolutely.
Art therapy, it enables the artist in each of us to put life in perspective. For Focus, I'm Grover Solcox reporting.
Thank you, Grover. For almost 90 years, the State Theater Center for the Arts in Easton has attracted world-class shows to its storied stage. Here with the highlights of the state's 88th season, Senior Vice President of Marketing, Jamie Balliott. Thank you
Hello.
For joining us
Thank
today.
Thank you for having me.
So what's new this season?
We are cooking. We are in the middle of the season right now, and there's a lot of stuff that's going on and on sale. We have great, great Broadway shows. Mamma Mia, Jekyll and Hyde, Sister Act is coming for the first time, which is very exciting. Incredible performers, Brian Setzer's back, Randy Newman, who's never been there before. And so we have whatever you can think of that you might like is probably on our stage, so you really need to check us out.
How many shows do you currently have scheduled?
Right now we have about 45 scheduled,
wow.
But we will announce another round of close to 10 shows in November. And then if anything comes along, we do continually add it. So there's always something new coming up. So it's important to just follow it and even become a member, because members always get first crack at tickets.
The holidays are always a big season at any theater. What do you have planned
for
the
holidays?
Oh, we
have some great holiday shows. We have our traditional Nutcracker and Christmas Carol. But this year we have a Holiday on Ice show. And yes,
at the state.
We're a theater and we can do magic. And so there's going to be ice on the stage. It's an actual ice show in State Theater, which is an intimate venue, 1,500 seats. So you never really get that sort of up close and personal to a show like that.
When you're in an historic theater like that, there are always renovations and updates happening. What will actually appear new in the state this
season?
Well,
this year we're very excited because we were able to replace our curtain, which is enormous and very heavy. And costs a lot of money, and it was really, really starting to fall down. And so we had a public campaign last year and raised $58,000 from the community to replace the curtain. And it rose to its glory on opening night. It was September 20th. And so thanks to everybody out there who supports this nonprofit theater, we were able to have that new curtain.
And where can people go to keep an eye on what's coming up?
www.statetheater.org.
And of course, at the end of the season, we always look forward to the Freddies.
The Freddies, it's our favorite thing at the State Theater. We love it, and we thank you for supporting the kids, and look out for their school schedule, their performance schedule, because it's important for you to get out there and support the schools as well.
We will always look forward to those high school musicals and seeing them come to life at the Freddies. Thank you for sharing all this information.
Thank you so much,
Jamie. Appreciate it. We created First Fridays on Focus thanks to viewer feedback. You told us you wanted to see more arts on PBS 39, and we listened. We love to hear from our viewers and encourage you to follow us on Facebook and Twitter at PBS 39 channel. You can also watch segments from our shows on our YouTube channel, so send us your feedback. Your ideas often end up on the air, and of course, that's how we find many of our ideas from viewers, and I loved what you did this week, Brittany.
Thank you. Yes, it was certainly a very fun First Friday. And I had my first time experiencing glass blowing. So my pumpkin's just a little bit crooked here, but I got a lot of help from John and Dennis. And as you can see, their work is featured in the studio today. It oftentimes does take a team of people to make these amazing sculptural, ornamental, and functional pieces.
They're just beautiful. But of course, creating beautiful artwork isn't exactly the goal of art therapy.
Not necessarily. I mean, it really is for just about anyone who needs to resolve issues in a creative way. And although some professional artists do go just for the supportive atmosphere.
Thanks, Grover. Thank you, Brittany. We'll see you next week. Until then, remember to focus on what matters.